In this corner, weighing in at a set of blueberries, the standard low-fat Republican, grand old Republican, who refuses to fight the Democrats the way they fight us, Governor Goofball. And in this corner, weighing in at a set of Vidalia onions, the teller of truth, the slayer of Democrats. Folks, people want a champion.
A man and his microphone.
Welcome to the program, America, your friendly neighborhood hatchet man, Brother Craig, coming at you live here on America's Big Dog Radio program, The Really Real Deal. And hey, we had a really, really fantastic event this morning. I want to say thank you for those of you who are listening and who were also present at this morning's event. There were several thousand people there gathered at the, I guess, was that the back door of the governor's mansion, the front door of the governor's mansion? You know, I'm not sure. That's a pretty big place. but we had a wonderful event. And Chris and Diana Shores did a really, really wonderful job organizing that event. And, you know, and we have the Democrat Party to thank for all this, you know, what they did up in New York and then the stumbles by Governor. I guess I need to start calling the Democrat governor, Governor Goofball. Okay, for years, for years, I've been calling, you know, Republican Senator Stupid and Republican Governor Goofball. Because, you know, our guys, God bless them, at least have the truth on their side. And that, you know, they're too, I don't know what you call it. They're weak, they're cowardly, they're ineffective, they're overly cautious, you know, they're Boy Scoutish and, you know, want to say that, you know, the other side, those are my friends across the aisle. Even in, you know, the Democrat Governor Goofball putting his foot in his mouth consistently and, you know, Mark Herring, the AG, and Justin Fairfax, the Lieutenant Governor, all their troubles, you know, none of the other two, none of their troubles would even have surfaced had Governor Northam just resigned. Okay, and so I'm just so glad that he did not resign. And, you know, all these pious and righteous, self-righteous, rather, calls from Republicans and Democrats for Ralph Northam to resign is really, it's really nonsensical. You want this guy. I can see why Democrats wanted him to resign because, you know, look at all the truth about these people that has come out because Ralph Northam did not resign, okay? And really, the only reason they really wanted him to resign was that he spoke the truth about aborticide and infanticide. He referred to the baby as an infant because he's a pediatrician and he knows that that is what it is. Now, the feminazi activists, they refer to the baby as a fetus, okay? And so the Democrat politicians that, you know, they accept all these millions of dollars in Planned Parenthood money. You know, Planned Parenthood is just a nice name that they put on what was originally called the Negro Project. I mean, make no mistake about it, folks. This was and is a eugenics organization. And so, you know, they've tried to morph their image to say we just want families to have proper planning and to become a parent when you're financially and emotionally more stable. Okay, that, you know, that's what they would say. But I say that the truth of that, they could make a claim for that being true if all the other positions that these Democrats pushed were positions that would upgird and support family, faith, freedom, the things that make for a happy and well-adjusted society. But they fight all these things, okay? They fight the idea in the Word of God that says male and female created he them. Well, first of all, they fight that there is a he, okay, that there is a God who did the creation, okay? Second thing they fight is that, you know, that this notion of male and female, that, oh, that's just, that's the patriarchy, okay, that there needs to be just people, not male, not female, not him, not her, not he, not she. Everyone needs to be called a they. You know, they engender all this confusion, and it's not confusion because on the part of the people pushing these ideas that there is a lack of understanding, okay? That's not what is happening here. What is happening here is a very cynical group of people who they know that they have had control of all centers of culture for 50 years, okay? They've had control of lower education. They've had control of academia, higher education. They've had control of Hollywood, the music industry, these same musicians that these two goofball Democrat politicians tried to dress up and imitate back when they were, I think Herring was 19 years old. Dr. Ralph Northam was 25. I mean, 25, that's kind of hard to, I can see the 19-year-old, but 25, I mean, come on now. You know, I mean, either he's lying or he's like the goofiest goofball I've ever seen in my entire life. OK, so but these people, they've had control of these institutions and they've pushed all this this coarsening societal information over the decades, whether it's, you know, it used to be songs about male and female interaction were a love song and it was tender. Okay. And now these rappers, these are not rappers like what Mark Herring was trying to dress up as, you know, Curtis Blow. That was just child's play back in 1979. These rappers now, they're nasty and they're vile. And the types of things that they sing about, these are the types of things that Justin Fairfax, the lieutenant governor, is accused by a very intelligent, very dignified, very accomplished college professor out in California. Okay. She is accusing him of doing the very thing. And now with them, this was not in the 70s, like this blackface stuff was back in the 1970s and 1980s. Okay. 79. And I think for Northam, it was 1984, right? With Justin Fairfax, his indiscretion was in 2004, okay? And so he's much younger than the other two. So he's had more years to absorb the degradation of the filth that Hollywood, academia, that all these places that they push out there, okay? And one of the things the feminazis wanted to do was destroy the idea of the gallant, gentlemanly male who courts his woman, okay? And they wanted to be like, okay, why can't the woman just have a hookup like the man? Why does the man get to have the hookup and walk away? You know, why can't it just be equal? Why can't they just be like two dogs in the street, you know? The female goes in heat. Yeah, come on, bring it on, bring it on, bring it on, you know? And so this is what they've taught. So then, now, this, again, with Justin Fairfax, it happened in 2004, okay? And this is the type of society you get when you remove God from the equation, okay? This is exactly what you get. And so, in his case, he's acting out, or he was accused, rather, of acting out in the manner in which the, you know, when he was a young man, it, you know, it wasn't these innocent little rap songs. You know, it was nasty and filthy and, you know, she's a B.I. itch and, you know, I'm going to do it to her hard and I'm going to grab her and make her do this, that, and the other. You know, this is the type of filth that these people, they glorify this. They give these people awards, okay? I mean, and it's now, it's even worse than in 2004. Now, They will invite a drag queen to come to your school to read books to your little five-year-old. This is the society that we are reaping because of the seed that either we have planted or we who are Christian conservatives have allowed to be planted because we refuse to fight back. Now, we're going to take our first break of the day, and when we come back, we're going to have a guest who's going to join us on the pro-life movement. She's from the Heritage Foundation.
This is a man's world. This is a man's world.
Well, welcome back to the program, America. Your friendly neighborhood hatchet man, Brother Craig, coming back at you live here on Man's World Radio, the really real deal. And you just heard the giving ad there, and freedom is not free. And so to all of you who have been donors, not only to my organization, the First Amendment, Inc., helping to foot the bill to keep your friendly neighborhood hatchet man slinging the hatchet of truth on the air. And it, trust me, it's really, really needed. But, you know, not only you who have donated here, but you who are givers and who foot the bill for all the different organizations. Because where I was this morning, there were many organizations there, and all of them need donations. So I ask you out there to dig deep. There's a lot of news about pro-life and all of the treachery that Democrats are doing. But if you, the listener, you, the voter, you, the citizen, if you don't dig deep and help them, then, their mission cannot get accomplished, nor can mine. And so if you want to share some of that my way, hey, you go to thefirstamendmentinc.com, thefirstamendmentinc.com. And again, thank you. And also our guest, Melanie Israel, I want to say thank you to you. Melanie is a research associate at the DeVos Center for Religion and Civil Society at the Heritage Foundation, one of our favorite groups. And thank you so much, Melanie.
Well, thank you for having me.
Yeah. I was reading your recent article about Planned Parenthood and how people really need to dig into the details, even something as simple as just looking at the financial report of an organization as large as Planned Parenthood. A lot of things increase and a whole lot of things decrease. You want to share the details?
Sure. And I should note, this is the first of Planned Parenthood's annual report under the leadership of their new president. And so it will be something to watch here in the coming years to see how her leadership compares to that of her predecessor, Cecile Richards. Mm-hmm. But the, top line thing that people should know is that Planned Parenthood performed over 330,000 abortions in 1 year. Mm-hmm. And that was the most that they have reported doing in almost a decade.
Yeah. And then all of the things, and they claim to be doing women's health and all of the health exams. I have it here: breast exams, cancer screenings, well woman exams, birth control provisions and information services, all went down, but especially adoption referrals went way down.
Yes, way down. There's been really over the last decade and more a sharp drop off in adoption referrals. And now we're to the point where Planned Parenthood is performing 118 abortions for every adoption referral.
Wow. This is our main argument is that, okay, when there's, because people are going to have sex in ways that would not be advisable. Okay. That is going to happen. And so when these unplanned pregnancies occur, I mean, people in America go to foreign countries looking to adopt babies. Am I overstating it?
Not at all. There are so many men and women out there who are looking to adopt children. And so it's very surprising that this is something that Planned Parenthood apparently has no interest in participating in, because mm-hmm. we have a very invigorated adoption and foster care system in America. And of course, we're seeing many children entering the foster care and adoption system due to the opioid crisis. Mm-hmm. But we also know that there are many organizations out there who are reaching out to women experiencing an unplanned pregnancy to give them the option to choose adoption. And that's something that Planned Parenthood is not interested in doing.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just, it's a culture of death over there, and the money that they have. And, you know, why, you know, I fought President Trump for this. I don't know why he can't just veto any bill that has one red penny in it for Planned Parenthood. But I read here in your article that they have $1.9 billion in assets, up from $1.6 billion, and their taxpayer funding increased. They have well over, almost over half a billion, $563 million. Mm-hmm. In taxpayer funding, that's way up. Total revenue is way up. I mean, they have excess money. I mean, these are people. This is big money.
That's right, and they're also seeing a very large upswing in their fundraising that they're getting from private contributions. They've obviously been going out in recent years with a very savvy PR campaign. They have a lot of celebrity friends and people in the culture more broadly, Hollywood, things like that, who are helping them to promote this certain image rather than the fact that they are America's abortion giant. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Congress has made some attempts here and there to try to defund Planned Parenthood, but those attempts have not made it over the finish line. The Senate just last month voted on the no taxpayer funding for abortion bill that would permanently cut off the flow of money to abortion providers. And unfortunately, it could not get enough votes in the Senate to get past a filibuster.
Well, see, I don't even give them that excuse, because they have to do is go by 51% rule. They don't, this filibuster thing, that's not law, that's Senate tradition, and they can disband it at any time. They did it for Supreme Court nominations. They can do it here.
That's right. That's right. To point that out, this is not based on law or statute. This is based off of
tradition. Yes.
Correct.
Yes. And they can dispense with it tomorrow. If the senators had a set of onions, they could dispense with this tomorrow. Okay. Because you never, ever. And what it is, it's an excuse for inactivity. Okay. And because many of the so-called conservatives, they want to be conservative when it comes to the finances and the border and things overseas, but they don't, the social issues, they want us to just go away. Now, did you attend the Commonwealth March this morning?
I was not able to attend. I am here in D.C., but I saw so many pictures of it on social media. I had coworkers coming and showing me pictures, and
it was wonderful.
What a turnout.
It was wonderful, I tell you. And now we're about a minute from the break. So what else is on your agenda? And, you know, share with our audience how folks can get in touch with you and what other projects you have concerning the pro-life movement.
Sure. So we are providing all kinds of commentary and analysis at heritage.org. Obviously, one of the things that is very much in the news right now is attempts to pass a bill to protect infants who are born alive following an abortion procedure. The House and the Senate are going to continue agitating to, if not pass the bill, at least get some people on record showing which side of this.
Thank you.
It shouldn't even be an argument,
yes.
But which side are you on? It shouldn't be controversial. It's a matter of human decency.
Yeah. Amen. God bless you for all that you do. And again, this is Melanie Israel at the Heritage Foundation. Thank you so much, Melanie.
Thanks for having me.
All right. God bless you now.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. All right, folks, we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back and open up the phone lines.
You can run on for a long time. Run on. For a long time, run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down.
Welcome back to the program, America. Your friendly neighborhood Hatchet Man, Brother Craig, coming back at you live. The number here, if you would like to participate, 804-454-1366. 804-454-1366. And we want to get back on the subject that the entire nation seems to be talking about these days, and it is my home state of Virginia. Look, even up in New York, New York actually passed the law that Virginia almost passed, okay? And the only thing that stopped Virginia from passing it was one Republican, okay? Just one. If we'd had one less Republican and one more Democrat, the New York law, okay? And, you know, in case you've been sleeping under a rock for the last 2 or 3 weeks, in New York, aborticide is now legal, not just through the end of the ninth month, but after the baby is born, infanticide, okay? And, they can kill the baby afterwards, okay? And one of the architects of Obama scam, Zeke Emanuel, you know, he was in favor of this years ago. And then once he got called out on it, he took a couple of steps back. But this is what is in the hearts of these people, folks. Okay, this is what is in their hearts. You know, they feel like the child does not know what's going on. And so if the child is undesirable, you know, you just go ahead and snuff the life out. All right. So New York, who has passed this, and even, you know, some knuckle dragging guy in a T-shirt beats his girlfriend up and she's pregnant and she loses the baby. It used to be, before this law passed in New York, that he would be guilty of murder. OK, now he would go to prison for murder. All right. Now he would be guilty only of assault. Okay, and so he would get up. But these Democrats, they love women. They love children, okay? And now we who are fighting for that woman, we who are fighting for that child, they say we hate women and we hate children, okay? And they have so many more media outlets to tell the lie. You know, it's an old saying, for a reason, it says that the a lie can go around the world 10 times before the truth puts its pants on. And there's some truth to that. But, I'm not one who likes excuses. OK, now here I have a radio program, many talk radio. I think probably 95%+ of talk radio people are conservative at a minimum. And many are Christian conservative. All right. For whatever reason, the lies that they tell on television, they don't translate as well into radio. OK. You got a handful of guys in radio. They are the neoliberal leftists, members of the Coalition of Evil, Al Sharpton, a few others. There's so few, I can't even name any of them other than Al. But this whole issue that we're dealing with, where even in New York, like I said, the whole nation is talking about Virginia, and the New York Post had a full page headline that said Virginia is for losers. Okay, and now I'm not going to get into trying to defend the three, talking about the three people up at the top, but see, the reality is the three people up at the top got elected. They got elected. And so how do these animals win election? Okay, and how did Republicans almost lose the House of Delegates? And how is it that nationally the Republicans did actually lose the House of Representatives, okay? And they're holding on in the Senate, and in the state of Virginia, they're barely holding on to the Senate, okay? You know, how is that? Because these people, they get elected. They go out and they tell their lies, they purchase votes, they bribe people, they give them free stuff, or they promise them free stuff, and Republicans don't fight, okay? So how can you win if you won't fight? How can you win if you refer to the enemy as my friend across the aisle? Answer, you can't. Okay. And this is eugenics, plain and simple. Okay. The Oxford Dictionary calls eugenics the science of improving a population by controlled breeding to increase the occurrence of desirable heritable characteristics. Okay. And that is what it is. The Nazis targeted people as a life unworthy of life, okay? Lebenswertsleben, a life unworthy of life, okay? Never forget that. These people are the Nazis of our day, and these low-fat Republicans that will not fight them are cowards. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back. Welcome back to the program, America. Your friendly neighborhood Hatchet Man, Brother Craig, coming back at you live here. And, you know, I'm kind of tempted. Some folks had asked me that heard my speech this morning if I would read my speech on the air today. I was planning to do it in this segment here. But I think what I'm going to do, I'm going to continue sharing some other things. And you know, I think the speech was best delivered in the environment where I delivered it. And there were recordings made. And so I'll have to get a recording and upload it into the radio station here. And we'll try to have that for you Monday. And maybe we'll play that Monday. I think it would be better. I think it would have come across better that way. And plus, I kind of ad-lib some things. Okay, and I can't replicate what I ad-libbed, okay? So, anyway, and we're looking forward. I think we're going to have many of the people that were there, we're going to have as guests coming up in the next week or so. And we already have a pretty good roster of guests. I think we have Star Parker coming next week. We have Brigitte Gabriel coming, a few others. I don't have the list in front of me right now, but we're going to try to, you know, get some of these people. Even the women's event that I moderated last week, you know, Tawana Hampton, who was one of the presenters there, she has a wonderful organization that I would encourage you to check out. Her website is godsballot.org, godsballot.org. And, God, don't we really need Reverend Chickenfoot to check that out now. Now, if Reverend Chickenfoot won't check it out, then, you know, maybe one of the deacons or the deaconesses can check it out and tell Reverend Chickenfoot, Reverend Chickenfoot, you got to check this out. Godsballot.org. Okay. And, you know, her testimony was that she had been voting Democrat out of, just habit and family tradition, and had never really given it a whole lot of thought. It was just, that's what you did, you know, as a African-American or a black female, you just, that's just kind of what you did. And I can really understand that, although I've never voted for a Democrat in my life, but I do see all of the pressure that, you know, because black Americans vote 90% Democrat. There's a lot of pressure. There's a lot of anger and hatred that comes my way. I mean, now, fortunately for me, you know, I'm the Hatchet Man. So, of course, I have very, very thick skin. OK, those jokers, they can call me anything other than late for dinner. I don't care. OK, so I'm going to do my thing. And I'm going to, you know, it says the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. I'm going to fear God. I'm not going to fear these people. You know, because God's word says that there are only two types of people, those that are the fearful and those that fear God only. And I fear God only. I want to do what God wants me to do. And so her website, God's Ballot, she's sharing that once she started paying attention and started asking questions and looking into what do these Democrat office holders actually represent. And then asked herself a question, does that comport with my values? Okay. And the answer to her was a resounding no. Okay. And this is what I find with many Americans of all stripes. And it's not just black Americans that vote Democrat now, although It is the only demographic group in America that votes in such a high degree, 90%. My goodness, it's a lot of people that can't think, okay, or that place emotion and tradition and what you were taught, and it's just maybe intellectual laziness. You know, it's probably a variety of things, okay, but that's a higher percentage than a homosexual Americans. Homosexuals only vote Democrat at a rate of 80%, okay? So even 20% of homosexuals have enough sense to know that if the Muslims take over, they're going to throw me off of a building, okay? So what are the Republicans going to do? Quote Bible verses at me? You know, so even they have that much sense not to let emotion get in the way of their intellect, okay? And, you know, and blacks can't do that, all right? And so it's going to take going around these centers of influence. That is the only way for it to happen. And so, you know, I have many, many Republican friends who for years, you know, they will boast, oh, man, I've made friends with the NAACP, and I went over there to, I've been going to their meetings for the last 3 or 4 months, and, yeah, we break bread together, and, you know, next month I'm going to have me another meeting with my good friends over at the NAACP, you know, and I'm thinking to myself, I bet you paying for the lunch. Those jokers, you're talking to the leadership, okay? The leadership over there at the NAACP and all these other Negro groups, the leadership, these people, you know, 95+% of them. Now, if you're one out there and you're in the very, very small minority that actually is concerned about your society and you're not a poverty pimp, okay, I apologize to you, and you're welcome to call and defend yourself and explain why you are the exception. But the general rule is that you have to go around the gatekeepers, okay? These are the gatekeepers of the black community, and they're never, ever, ever gonna let us in and have access on an equal footing to share wisdom, particularly in a debate format, which I've invited these people for years and years and years, okay, to debate the Hatchet Man. Those jokers run like cockroaches, okay? They run. They will not debate me. They will not debate any real Christian conservative. They'll debate a low-fat Republican because the low-fat Republican is going to be too polite, okay? And they're going to mop the floor with that person, but not the Hatchet Man. Anyway, we're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back. The number, if you'd like to call, 804-454-1366, 804-454-1366.
What they do, they smile in your face.
All the time they want to take your place, the backstabbers.
Welcome back to the program, America. Your friendly neighborhood Hatchet Man, Brother Craig, coming back at you live, wrapping up our first hour of today's program. And, you know, sitting here looking online at, you know, all these stars, and they're all Democrats, okay, who have done blackface. And, you know, and these people want to take the eye of the public off of the 57 million aborted babies. And as far as the black community is concerned, almost half of that 57 million, you know, estimates vary, but anywhere from 21 to 25 million. You know how many nations on this earth do not have 25 million people in the entire nation? And yet since 1973, that's how many black babies have been killed. And the eugenicists, like Margaret Sanger, who said, hey, we, you know, we'll keep this quiet now. We don't want black folks to know we're trying to exterminate them, okay? But we're going to get their preachers, we're going to give their preachers a little money, and we're going to tell them that it's family planning, okay? And you know, once we get their approval, oh, it'll fly real easy then, okay? The Negro Project, okay? Black people are like human weeds. I mean, this is absolutely what it's all about. But they think, oh, just do some blackface and get these poverty pimp Negro politicians to come to our rescue so we can get rid of Governor Northam and get that aborticide issue out of the news. And the whole thing has backfired because both issues are in the news. The aborticide, the blackface, racism, the young lieutenant governor, and you know, and the aggressive sex he had with this woman 15 years ago when they were both, you know, in their early 20s. I think they were both in college. Okay. And I'm not excusing it. I'm just giving you the truth. Okay. You know, I speak truth no matter who it's for or against. Okay. I'm not, you know, just because they're Democrats, I'm going to just run with anything. Okay. And ditto on Republicans. If just because a person is a Republican, I'm not just going to defend them. I'm going to give you honest analysis. Okay. And, you know, I think all three of these men are wicked. And but I think these arguments, particularly these blackface arguments, I mean, I'm looking at a picture here of Beyonce with black shoe polish on her face. OK, she's already a member of the black community, biracial, but she has black shoe polish on her face. And she is Michelle Obama's best friend. When Michelle Obama was asked in an article, if you could be any woman in history other than the first lady, who would you be? She said Beyonce. Beyonce, not Rosa Parks, you know, not, you know, the first female fighter pilot. Beyonce. And here you've got Beyonce in blackface. Where's the outrage? We're going to take our top of the hour news break and we'll be right back.
Feeling my way through the darkness, guided by a beating heart. I can't tell where the journey will end, but I know where to start.
Welcome back to the program, America. Your friendly neighborhood Hatchet Man, Brother Craig, coming back at you live. And hey, our second and final hour of today's program. And the number here, if you'd like to participate, is 804-454-1366, 804-454-1366. And, you know, the and again, the subject we're on is what the whole nation is focusing on, my home state of Virginia. And now, of course, the mainstream media, CNN, MSNBC, ABC, NBC, CBS, you know, of course, they want to downplay the real truth of the matter and want to make it all about, oh, it's racism. Okay. And now typically anything Republican is racist. Anything Republican is, oh, you hate women or you degrade women. And here you have two Democrats in blackface, one Democrat who is alleged to have forced oral sex onto a woman. Okay. Now, when there's zero proof, and you know, you have a 50-year-old woman who's talking like a little girl, as you did with Brett Kavanaugh. Brett Kavanaugh was not accused of anything near what Justin Fairfax is accused of. It's nowhere near. Okay. The woman was not credible. And you know, Blasey Ford, she's like, my name is Blasey Ford, and I know I talk like I'm 13 years old, but I'm actually 55. And I know I look like I'm 70, but I'm only 55. I'm not 13. And I want to say that Brett Kavanaugh, you know, I really don't remember what happened. I don't remember the address. I don't remember the neighborhood, but I think I saw him hanging around the punch bowl. And so maybe perhaps he might have spiked the punch. I mean, and for weeks, I don't know who I was more angry at. The lying Democrats that dragged that man through the mud, or the weak Republicans that accorded this woman respect that she did not deserve. She did not deserve one iota of respect, okay? And these goofball Republicans, this is what galls me about Republicans. You know, Republican Senator Stu Pid. Republican governor goofball. It galls me because we have truth on our side. That whole Kavanaugh affair, the truth was obvious. A 10th grader could figure out what was going on. It, you know, it did not take a genius, okay? And I get so tired, I have to write everything in crayon for these people, and they can't even read crayon. But now, okay, you have a real credible situation, and you have an admission by Fairfax that sexual contact did in fact occur. The only thing different is that he's saying she wanted it. That's all. How many, now, how many times have you heard that? Oh, yeah, you know she wanted it. And like I said in the first hour, this man came of age in a time. So he's a younger man. And so he came of age at a time when these rappers, this is what they sing and they glorify, okay? You know, to kind of to take it from the woman, to do it, you know, do it hard and make her hurt and make her sweat. I mean, this is this, they call that entertainment, okay? Cop killer. And then the guy singing about shooting cops, now he plays a cop on TV. That's Democrats. That's the society we live in. That's what happens when you live in a post-truth society. And the first thing they did was they kicked God out of the Constitution. And see, many of you don't know, but I'm president and founder of the First Amendment, Inc. And, you know, this is a good opportunity to go back to the beginning of a lot of this. You know, and many people over the years have expressed frustration with me. You know, Brother Craig, if only we could just get prayer back in school. I don't understand why they ever took prayer out of school. Well, for one thing, I would, you know, you got teachers now, you've got tranny teachers, you've got crazy teachers. I don't want those teachers leading my child in prayer. I'll do that, okay? I'll do that. And but look, look, let me catch a breath and say hi to Horace. Did you say Horace is on the line?
Yeah, Brother Craig, it's Horace.
How you doing, brother? What's on your mind?
Hanging in there. I was listening to you earlier while I was going home, and you were talking about this abortion situation.
Yes.
I was listening to an interview this morning on another program, and they were interviewing a woman from Africa, and she was saying that the abortion gangs are in Africa now, trying to get people to abort their babies.
Yeah.
And, they are using a disguise called family planning.
Same thing they do here. And the Africans fought Obama on this issue because Obama tried to push off on the Africans the homosexuality and abortion. And I remember specifically more than one president of African nations telling Barack Hussein Obama, no, we're not going to do it. Do you remember that?
Yes. Yeah. I was very, what she described, and she called Obama's name.
Ooh, wow.
He was one of the main movers behind the whole thing. You know, they got a lot of money. They funded them. And they're pushing the family planning situation, but she said it's really abortion.
Mm-hmm.
They're trying to get the people to abort their kids.
Mm-hmm.
And all this blackface and Ku Klux Klan thing that you see going on here, it is just a cover for the infanticide that they have been planning and trying to promote.
And it's the Democrats doing it, Horace. And and black people, look, why do black people still love Democrats? You know, I could see back when Republicans were running scared and, you know, couldn't quite figure it out. But all this truth now, every black young person has a cell phone on their hip that has a little supercomputer in it. Are you seeing cracks in this 90% support for the Democrats among blacks? Is it beginning to crumble?
No, I don't see it at all, Brother Craig, because two things that make me not realizing what that they are coming to themselves. First of all, when New York passed that crazy bill to kill the babies, I was talking to someone up in New York, and they said they didn't hear about it. And secondly, I have a family member who is a staunch Democrat, and he's even a deacon in the church. And I asked him, I said, "Well, how comes you support aborticide?" And he said, "What am I talking about?" I said, "Well, your party believe in abortion, killing babies when they are in their third trimester." And all they're trying to tell me is that all they know is that they hate Trump.
Wow.
That's what Dr. King warned.
Dr. King said, on our rise from poverty to power, we cannot drink from the cup of bitterness. And all the Democrats do is they force feed bitterness and hatred down these people's throats, and they're not self-thinkers. Now, is it intellectual laziness, or just the it's going to take time because the culture has grown, and we got 30 seconds?
Well, time is going on, Brother Craig, and I feel for my people. I'm sorry for them because they invest so much money into listening to these garbage over the television station that if we don't pull them away from that, their mind is going to be poisoned.
Yeah, we have to compete in the entertainment arena better, and we have to win people. But anyway, I really appreciate you, Horace, and I appreciate your listenership and your calling in. God bless you, brother.
Thank you very much.
All right. We're going to take a quick break, folks, and we'll be right back. 804-454-1366.
This is a man's world. This is a man's world.
Welcome back to the program, America. Man's World Radio, your friendly neighborhood hatchet man. Brother Craig, coming back at you live here on The Really Real Deal. And, if you'd like to participate, the number is 804-454-1366. Now, I want to share some things with you here, on this subject. I'm so glad Horace called, and, he's a gentleman who is a thinker and is not easily fooled. Now, many people are fooled by this this little racial okey-doke that they pull to get people off of the dirty little secret of eugenics. And it literally is genocide. You're talking about 25 million black people dead, and folks are supposed to get upset because someone put some skin darkening, shoe polish on. And then here, I just show you how you have black, light-skinned black people have done it. Beyonce, and she's not the only one. And all these white Democrat actors and actresses, they've done it. Okay, Ted Danson was dating Whoopi Goldberg, and Whoopi was fine with it. Okay, so it's nothing. Okay, I'm not offended by it. I think it's stupid. All right, now I'm on a website called Flashback. Okay, and this is about the top 10. Eugenicists, and they're saying that eugenics, this idea to produce better human beings, has existed since Plato. And see, now you've heard me over the years talk about Plato versus Hippocrates, how Plato wanted the government to run healthcare. Hippocrates, the father of the Hippocratic Oath, wanted government out of healthcare. Okay, because see, this is a deal with Plato. The government, wants to run everything. Now, the name of eugenics was developed by Francis Galton, the half cousin of Charles Darwin. And see, in Charles Darwin, his theory was all about race and inferior races. Okay. Now, this stuff eventually led to Nazi concentration camps. And the number one person on the list is Marie Stopes. She wrote a book on this subject and sent it to Hitler, okay? Now, this woman founded the first birth control clinic in London, in North London, in 1921. They even gave her, honored her with a stamp in 2008. She wrote a magazine called Birth Control News that she set up in 1922. This woman was such a hardcore eugenicist that she wrote that the horde of the hordes of defectives should be reduced so as to not be more of a burden on the what she called the fit. Okay, she disinherited her own son because he married a woman who was short-sighted and therefore risked a less than perfect grandchild. She described Southern Italians as a low-grade race and said of the French, they should eliminate the taint of their large numbers of perverted or homosexual people, okay? We're going to welcome Jeff from Richmond onto the line. What's on your mind, Jeff? Jeff, you're on live.
Hello.
Yes, you're on live, Jeff.
All right. Yes, sir. I was calling to see what happened with Governor Allen or Senator Allen when he said the macaca thing.
He was a coward. This is what happened with that. Okay. A macaca is like an idiot. I think his mother grew up in, you know, some part of the world where that type of terminology would be something like, that's like saying, oh, you're stupid or you're an idiot. And what they said was a macaca is a type of monkey. And because the young man who was a Democrat there filming him, because he was Indian from India, not Native American, he was of Indian descent. So he had brown skin. So therefore, rather than saying, oh, this idiot over here, that would have been almost like George Allen saying, you know, look at this little nigger over here, okay? And really, you have to be able to describe the actions of people that you disagree with in disagreeable terms. You have to be able to say, you're an idiot, that's wrong, that's stupid, it doesn't make sense. And political correctness doesn't allow you to do that. And so that's all George Allen had to do, was to just answer it like that. But because Republicans are so fearful of being called racist, he backpedaled, and then the next thing you know, he was saying, you know, someone said, oh, well, aren't you part Jewish? You have, like, someone in your family's Jewish. Oh, no, I'm not, you know, I'm not part Jewish. He started denying even his heritage, and it turns out he is. This is the trap that Republicans fall into. That was just an innocent statement. He could have, rather than say macaca, he could have said, look at this knucklehead.
Right, exactly.
And it's just simple. Just people need to just communicate like you would anyone else, because if it had been a white guy and he would have said, look at this stupid knucklehead, there would have been no issue. But because the guy has brown skin, the Democrats manipulate what he said into a racial issue, and it cost him a Senate seat.
Right. And one of the things that happened during that time was, I remember that companies like a Rolls Royce and, you know, large name companies like General Dynamics and stuff were threatening to leave the Commonwealth because of that statement. And it's interesting that nobody,
go ahead,
Amazon or nobody else that is here is threatening to leave because it's a Democrat.
Exactly. And see, and this is a dirty little secret. These big giant companies, they want Democrats in power because the Democrat Party is a coalition between the super rich and those that are educated beyond their usefulness and beyond their intelligence. Don't ask me how they get all these college degrees, but these are like a lot of goofball people that are very theoretical, and they cannot logically apply their knowledge to everyday life. And so they live off the government. And in capitalism, what they live off is crony capitalism. Government favors. Did you know that this guy, Elon Musk, he's never turned a profit, but he's a billionaire? So he loves, he's a crony capitalist. He could not survive. He could not survive under pure capitalism. So this is the dirty little secret. It's a marriage between the super rich and the poor, and then ordinary people who earn a living. We're crushed in the middle, okay? They give crumbs to the poor, and then the rich get their perks that are unseen, but they're getting them. And so this is why you have not seen and you will not see any company come out and say, we're going to pull out unless you fire these Democrats, because they love Democrats.
I appreciate your voice, and I listen to you every time I can. So thank you very much for what you do.
Oh, God bless you, sir. That's very kind of you, and thank you for calling.
Good day.
All right. We're going to take our bottom of the hour news break, folks, and we'll be right back. Welcome back to the program, America. Your friendly neighborhood hatchet man, Brother Craig, coming back at you live. Our final 30 minutes of today's program. If you'd like to participate, the number is 804-454-1366. 804-454-1366. Now, I'm going to get back on this. I highly encourage you to go to this this website called Flashback. And, you know, I was talking about Maurice Stopes, who is this big time eugenicist, one of the early eugenicists of the last century. She wrote a poem that included this line: Catholics, Prussians, the Jews, and the Russians all are a curse or something worse. I mean, this is and see, folks, people think we're being hyperbolic when we talk about the Democrats, but when you get to, whenever you get away from the Word of God, okay? Now, St. Paul, in his letter to the Ephesians, says that there is no black, no white, no male, no female. And I'm modernizing it now, so you all just hold on out there. I know it doesn't say that with precision. But no black, no white, no male, no female, no Jew, no Gentile, no rich, no poor, but all are of one blood through Christ Jesus. Okay? And see, when you get away from that, and this has been the creed of the Republican Party, and see, even through all this debacle that's going on, Republicans are running scared. They're not touching it. You don't see Republicans swarming all over, the Democrats. Now, if the thing was reversed, the Democrats will be over the Republicans like buzzards over a dead body, okay? And this is just, you know, they'd be, oh, look at this, roadkill, Republican roadkill. You know, call the family. Come on, y'all, let's get us some. This is just the reality of the focus and aggression that Democrats have on winning at all costs. They would even lie in order to win. They kill people to win. They kill babies to win. They miseducate people in inner city schools to win, to make sure they have an angry population to cause problems so that they can have a job, which is to do what? Solve the problems that these angry people create. And they create the angry people. It's a vicious cycle. Republicans, on the other hand, here they have a perfect opportunity. The top three, here we are in a center-right state, there's 72 in Virginia. The nation, the entire nation is 70% center-right. The nation is 70% Christian. My home state of Virginia is 72% Christian. And yet and still, the top elected officials, the top three plus both senators, okay? So the top five elected officials in the state of Virginia are Democrats, okay? And, you know, why Republicans are not swarming all over this, you know, they're running scared. Bunch of cowards. You wait till the primary season comes around. I'm praying, Lord, let some really, really awesome Christian warriors run in these primaries across the entire state of Virginia, across the whole country. Let them challenge these weak, ineffective, cowardly, low-fat Republicans. You have a great president in office that you won't support, and you have weak Democrats that are destroying themselves, and you don't know how to pounce. You know, these people could not fight a war. These people couldn't be a boxer. You know, they don't have any killer instinct. This is just ridiculous. It really is ridiculous, okay? But the simple fact is that what I'm sharing with you from this website flashback, all right, and, you know, and I could go through. The next guy up on the list is H.G. Wells, the author of The Time Machine, The Invisible Man, The Island of Dr. Moreau, The War for the Worlds, you know, books and movies that many of us, particularly of a certain age, have either read the book or seen the movie or maybe both, okay? He's another big-time eugenicist, okay? Kill people that they think are going to weaken the gene pool, okay? And so these people that the Democrats claim to love and have convinced to vote for them, they want to kill them and then replace them with more people from other countries that are pliable and that they can load onto a bus, drive them to the voting booth, and tell them for whom to vote. And that is what it's all about. We're going to take another quick break, and we'll be right back.
You can run on for a long time, run on for a long time, run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down.
Welcome back to the program, America. Your friendly neighborhood hatchet man, Brother Craig. And we're going to say welcome to the program, Wes. It is. Wes, what's on your mind, brother? Are you there, Wes?
Yep. Can you
hear me? I can hear you now. What's on your mind, Wes?
Okay. Well, the sin of abortion or infanticide is really what it is. One thing people have got to understand, and I'm saying this from the degree that I have, is the reason why you can't hear an infant scream as they take the forceps and crush its skull and pierce its spine with forceps is because it is still relying on the mother for the oxygen in its body through the bloodstream and the umbilical cord that is still attached to it. So people have to understand that it hasn't even taken its first breath. It is relying on the oxygen and the blood supply from the mother.
Yeah. And it used to be a saying, when someone wanted to say about something that's safe, they would say as safe as a baby in its mother's womb. And I bet that baby is doing a silent scream. Like I remember seeing a painting. I don't know if it was Picasso or some famous painting of a man on a bridge holding his hands up to his head with his mouth open and his eyes looking wide. And the title of that painting is The Scream.
Right. You can't hear that scream on that painting, but
right.
The reality of that child, it has not even taken its first breath and it's being murdered.
Yeah.
As far as I'm concerned.
And the thing, and the sad thing about it is that on our side, we who love life, we want to teach these people prior to having an unwanted pregnancy. We want to teach them how to be more circumspect and, you know, and how to be chaste and how to have sex under the protection of wedlock and not to just indiscriminate. And these same people fight us on that. They fight us when we try to teach young children to wait. They want, what they want to do is unleash all the animal passion that people have so that they will vote Democrat. They don't want to be the adult that says, no, you cannot do that.
Well, there's a movie out, I think it was on the internet. I lived on Parker Ave. It was basically about a young woman that found herself pregnant. She went to an abortion clinic. Her feet are in the stirrups, and she is about ready to have an abortion performed. and there's a protest outside, and somebody, she heard some other woman say, your baby is alive and can, and you know, save that child. And she got up and ran out of the abortion clinic, and that child is alive today because she did that.
I lived on Parker Ave. Okay, I just wrote that down. I'm going to Google that movie when I get home. I lived on Parker Ave. Thank you for sharing that, Wes.
Absolutely. Have a good day.
You too. God bless.
God bless.
All right. 804-454-1366 is the number. 804-454-1366. And, you know, back to this website I was on, Flashback. H.G. Wells is on the list. And let me read you some of the stuff. Wow, this guy wrote, okay? The way of nature has always been to slay the hindmost, and there is still no other way unless we can prevent those who would become the hindmost being born. It is in the sterilization of failures, not in the selection of successes for breeding, that the possibility of an improvement of the human stock lies. Also, the mating of two quite healthy persons may result in disease. I'm told it does so in the case of interbreeding. I mean, these people are wicked. And we're going to, who would have? Edison? Edison, what's on your mind, brother?
I appreciate everything you're doing. I really enjoy your new slot and everything. And
thank you, brother.
I really do. Brother, I just, you know, I am so tired of all this racial. This side of the table is clean and this side of the table is dirty.
Yeah.
You know, I come up in a time, I'm the same age you are, but look here, I come up in the time where people did a lot of crazy stuff, man.
Oh,
you know,
yeah.
And they made mistakes. And
none are righteous. You know, no, not one.
All is sin is fall short of the glory of God. You know, I'm just saying that, you know, but if you're going to be in a political office, they seem to have to be held to a higher standard than we do. But that's not true in the eyes of God. We should be held to the same standard out here.
And
I just think, you know, I don't want to, you know, I can't tell you anything new. And I can't tell you anything about being a black man. You can't tell me anything about being a white man, but I am so tired of hearing this racial. Well, I just don't know white folks now. I just don't know black folks now. I don't.
Yeah,
you know,
it's 2019, you know, and the thing about it is that the Democrats are losing their grip, I think. I think that we're starting to see the crack, and Trump is partly responsible for that. There are many. See, I've been saying forever, haven't you heard me for years say this, Edison?
Yeah.
That there are many Democrats who have calluses on their hands and work boots on their feet, that they are not buying all that Democrat bull crap. Haven't I been saying that?
That is what you've been saying. That's
yeah.
Sure.
You see,
God
and
bless you.
Thank
Keep
you, brother.
Good fight.
All right. God bless you too. And now time is short. And so I'm not going to read all of these. I'm just going to go through the list and just give you the quick version of some of these. Next on the list, I was really shocked at this one, Helen Keller. Helen Keller wrote, "Our puny sentimentalism has caused us to forget that a human life is sacred only when it may be of some use to itself and to the world." She also called for physicians' juries for defective babies, who would then vote on which children would be kept alive and which would not. It is the possibility of happiness, intelligence, and power that give life its sanctity. I mean, folks, she calls letting a defective child die was simply weeding of the human garden, and that it really shows a sincere and true love of life. These people are wicked. That's Helen Keller, okay? Helen Keller, the blind, deaf woman who someone with the love of God in her taught her how to read and how to speak. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back.
This is a man's world. This is a man's.
Welcome back to the program, America. Man's World Radio. It's been a tough program today, folks. And I mean, it's some of the stuff to read. It's tough to read. But, you know, we're men, we're women, we're Christians. We love truth. We're mature enough to face truth. We know we do not have the world we wish we had. We have the world that we have, and we have responsibility in it. And if it is to be improved, it is up to us to improve it. And if we fail in that regard, then the people that want to improve the world in their way, which I've read you about a whole lot of these people, they want to kill, okay? Kill, steal, and destroy. That's satanic. They are really, really dedicated to their way of improving the world. How dedicated are you? How dedicated am I? Last one I'm going to share with you today is George Bernard Shaw, another very, very celebrated and famous writer, okay? Another Fabian socialist, okay? Founder of the, or co-founder of the London School of Economics, very, very ardent socialist, okay? Some of his writings here. The moment we face it frankly, we are driven to the conclusion that the community has a right to put a price on the right to live in it. If people are fit to live, let them live. If they are not fit to live, kill them in a decent human way. And the way he thought was decent and human was a gas chamber, okay? That's George Bernard Shaw, socialist, okay? And so you go down the list, folks, the coalition of evil, the socialists, the communists, the fascists, the Muslim fundamentalists. What do they all have in common? They kill people. What do they all want to do? First thing, take your guns. Next thing, control education, what goes into the minds of your children, okay? Next thing, start killing people. And they want to be God. They want to have the power of life and death over you. Okay? And so we need to fight this. We need to fight not only this aborticide issue, but we need to fight Democrats everywhere Democrats exist. Okay? And I mean that with every fiber of my being. If you're a Democrat out there, Ma and Pa Democrat, I'm really not talking about you because I'm trying to win you over. But the people you vote for, I want to defeat them, every last single one of them. I really, really do. And I'm going to leave this last word to you. I know today's program has been tough. It's been tough on me. Believe me on that. But I'm just going to ask that the Lord would bless you and keep you, that the Lord would make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you, that the Lord would lift his countenance up upon you, and that the Lord would give you peace. I'm going to see you next week. Same hatchet time, same hatchet station.
A man and his microphone. Brother Craig.
If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd work for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife.